on you.
Sir?
It depends on you.
Large measure, that's true.
Sir?
In large measure, absolutely right.
Eva, how you doing?
Yep.
I have a jacket in my office, but it doesn't match, so I chose to be jacketless instead of matching.
All right, I'd like to call the July 27th. 27th, meeting to order. Be nice if I knew what night it was. We begin the meeting in our usual fashion of observing a moment of silence. And that will be followed by the pledge. If you would join me in a moment, sir. Thank you. If you would, please rise. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I'm going to, at this point, go directly into the heart of the matter and turn the program over to Mr. Lawrence, who is going to give us a presentation on the SF3 plan. Mr. Lawrence.
Thank you, Dr. Bradley, and members of the board. We do have a proposal that we have received input, ideas, suggestions from the community and various stakeholders. At this time, I'll ask members of our senior team if they will come forward to make the presentation. I believe that Mr. Traxler and Mr. Glover are going to be leading that at this time. And before Mr. Traxler starts, this is the draft of the plan for your consideration and for you to have a chance to discuss and ask questions. And of course, to approve it as a draft for us to put it out to the public to make additional comments prior to a final approval on August 10th.
Good evening, Mr. Chair, board members, Mr. Lawrence. So we're tonight going to discuss the SR3 proposal. As you're aware, we've received several pots of federal funds over the last year plus, and this is the latest. Of course, as with the others, we have a lot of strings that are attached, so we'll provide some background info and then run through the requirements of that and what our proposal is based on feedback. So, very briefly, some overview here. The American Rescue Plan was signed mid-March into law at the federal level. It was $121.9 billion allocated to SR3. South Carolina's allocation of that was $2.1 billion, 90% of that, of South Carolina's allocation, going to school districts. Aiken's cut from that is just short of $63.4 million. If you happen to look back and or recall some of our previous mentions, that's a little bit more than what we shared earlier. There was about a
$45,000-$48,000 increase due to a recalculation at the state level. So that's slightly more than what we previously shared. There is a September 30, 2024 deadline on these funds. There are 15 allowable uses here. Those uses are the exact same as ESSER II, but there are more strings that are attached. We've had several technical assistance webinars at this point from a variety of sources, but we continue to hear that there's going to be a heavy focus on that and results. What did you do with money, and what did you get from that? How did students respond, et cetera? At least 20% of the funds has to be spent on learning loss, so 20% of our allocation is approximately $12.7 million at a minimum for learning loss. The state's been very clear that ESSER pots ought to be spent chronologically. ESSER I, we're pretty much done with. There may be some very, very small pieces remaining on it. The ESSER II plan, this board approved the original plan, and in early March, we brought multiple revisions to this point, and our goal is to spend that before we get into ESSER III. The beauty of, I guess, the nice thing about ESSER II and ESSER III is that the 15 uses that apply to ESSER III are the same ones that apply to ESSER II, so there isn't any uniqueness there. This ESSER III requires two plans to be submitted. The first one this board's approved is that safe return to in-person instruction and continuity of services plan. It was presented in mid-June and submitted to the state by June 24th. That's a plan that the board will have to review at least every 6 months. I think we have a slight revision for consideration later on tonight. But every 6 months, through the life of ESSER III, will be at least every 6 months, we'll be bringing revisions or updates for the board's consideration, or at least we'll have discussions there to see if there is a need to change any items. The second plan that's required is the spending plan, and that's what we're bringing forward tonight as a draft proposal. That's going to be due to the state by August 24th. Again, that's something that if we anticipate, just like ESSER II, it's going to be fluid. There are going to be some changes throughout this plan over the next several years. ESSER III plan requires public input and meaning consultation. We want to get students, parents, families to provide input, teachers, school leaders, district administrators, et cetera. So this is something new. That's a requirement to have stakeholder feedback and consider it. Now we've had that to this point. Folks have had the opportunity for input during public participation, but this is more formal. That's a formal requirement, and I would anticipate as these funds are audited, it's probably one of the things that folks are going to look at, and that's one of the things that the state's going to look at too, just make sure that we follow those steps and that we receive that feedback and consider it. This is a nice slide, I thought, from one of those technical assistance sessions. It shows ESSER 1, 2, and 3. It is a State Department of Ed table, but it shows the legislation, it shows the period end date for these funds, what the allowable uses are, at least by number. There were 12, 15, and 15, and just other aspects of it. As a refresher, our ESSER I allocation was approximately $6.7 million. Our ESER II is approximately $28.2 million, and then this ESER III pot is approximately $63.4 million. There was a fourth pot that the district received during the year. It was coronavirus relief funds. It was approximately $2.6 million. Like ESER I, it was used largely for technology and one-to-one implementation. The 15 allowable uses, and I won't read these word for word, but the first one, an overall theme here, as you hear these and think about these are items that are, they should be to prepare for, to combat as a reaction to COVID. Some way or another, everything we're looking at has to relate to COVID, either a reaction to or a preparation for that continuation, or just dealing with the impacts there. So we can spend the funding on IDEA, Adult Ed, Perkins under item one. Item two is really to coordinate an emergency response to COVID. Item three is to address the needs of the highly vulnerable students, so those students that are most in need, taking steps to address their needs. Item four, ensuring preparedness and coordination, that's our systems and procedures that have been put in place related to COVID. Item five, training to adequately and appropriately sanitize our buildings, our facilities, and minimize the spread. Item six, purchasing supplies to sanitize and clean. Item seven is planning for and coordinating and implementing the activities during long-term closures. Hopefully we'll avoid that in the future, but item seven would address that. Item eight is for technology and related aspects of that. Use number nine, providing mental health services and support. Number 10 is implementing a summer learning program, after school supplemental programs. Item 11 are those procedures to address learning loss as a result of COVID, and if provide some additional aspects there to consider. Now, under ESER II, these next couple were new, and I'll read those a little bit word for word. So item 12, school facility repairs and improvements to enable operation of schools to reduce risk of virus transmission and exposure to environmental health hazards and to support student health needs. Item 13, inspection, testing, maintenance, repair, replacement, and upgrade projects to improve the indoor air quality of school facilities, etc. Item 14, developing health protocols for reopening operation of school facilities to effectively maintain health and safety of students, educators, and staff. And item 15 is vague and more of a catch-all, but again, with the thought process that somehow this has to relate to COVID. So if there's something that didn't fit in one of the other 14 categories, but is COVID related, that's, we could utilize that item number 15, assuming So as we, started this process, we put out a survey for all of our stakeholders to participate in, and it asked those folks to, rank the 15 categories. What's most important, what's least important in your eyes? And we had approximately 1,500 responses, which I don't think is a bad level of response for the time of year. For a random survey, of course, the, large majority of those folks that responded were parents, approximately two-thirds, but about a fourth of our teachers respond, and 140 or so other staff members. So we had a good response, and we took that into consideration as we were developing the plan. Whenever we look at the results of that, learning loss at approximately 43% of the vote there is, most important, as that highest priority, and technology was second. And then you have a variety of ones that were among the third, fourth, fifth items there. All of those were kind of in line with each other, but learning loss and technology were the top two for consideration. The survey also asked that, asked folks to chime in on, all right, as far as learning loss, what's the that best mode? And we heard that after school tutoring and remediation interventions during the day were those preferred methods, the ones that folks thought were either best or most likely to succeed. We had web-based support, summer programs, both at about 42%, and then some other. We gave respondents the opportunity to provide some other feedback as well, and those that we've summarized here were, ones that we saw with a recurring theme. We saw several responses, and, there were some that were singular, and I think you have copies of all of these in your purple folder, but we highlighted the ones that we saw with some frequency. So smaller class sizes was something that was mentioned. Now that's something that we've taken steps in our general fund to address somewhat. We lowered the pupil-teacher ratios in first, fourth, and fifth, and, we know that there's a goal to reduce those numbers even lower in future years. Additional professional staff, including tutors, moving to a year-round school schedule, additional reading interventionists, additional intervention programs. And recall that one of those ESSER II items was early interventionists at the elementary school. That's something that we, built into ESSER II plan. One-on-one technology, so one-to-one, and, we're well on our way there, but also having adequate internet access. And we had several responses too asking us not to accept those funds. So that was among that. At our June principals meeting, we, met with principals, asked in groups that they get together and talk about things. We have a lot of good feedback from principals and directors and others in that meeting. I'm not going to go through all of these because it's, a pretty extensive list. It's about four pages worth, and there may be some that you may look at it and you may have to take a roundabout way to relate them to COVID. Some are more direct, but we think all are good responses and are, items that we summarized, we looked at and considered as we worked on, this proposal. The first item on our draft proposal is addressing learning loss. That's where we're required to spend at least 20% of this to address learning loss, and Ms. Glover is going to join and speak on that.
Good evening, Chairman Bradley, members of the board, and Mr. Lawrence. So as Mr. Traxler mentioned, 20%, a minimum of 20% has to be spent on learning loss, and we're proposing that $15 million, which is above the 12 and change million that's required for learning loss, we're asking for 15. Many of these items, and you'll see in the next few slides, I have in black items that were approved in ESSER 2 that we're asking to continue another year or another couple of years, and then the items in red are the new requests. So the first is the K through 2 interventionists that Mr. Traxler mentioned. That would extend those positions another year, and for the 23-24 school year, we would add an additional one for a new school possibly coming on, Highland Springs Elementary. And then we wanted to continue to do after school and Saturday school programs, our summer school programs during the summers of 23 and 24. And those costs would include that $7 million, the supplies, as well as the salaries. I think you may have mentioned, Mr. Traxler, about these plans being fluid, spending ESSER 2 before we spend ESSER 3. We'll be coming back to the board at the end of September with our, if we can get that on the schedule then, for our summer programs now that are finishing up. So we'll have a better idea of actually what those costs are when payrolls finish up in August and all of our bills are paid, so that we, you know, this might not be the exact dollar amount when we look at possibly amending moving forward. But right now we're asking for $7 million for 23 and 24. Then when we presented before, we asked for some digital resources and contracts to support learning loss, and those are listed here, Learning A to Z, which those are digital texts to support one-to-one. Reflex Math focuses on fact fluency, which when we shared our data before is a big need in our elementary grades. Quill focuses on grammar. Marco is an AP software program, helps with writing. BrainPop has videos for science. SEL, social emotional learning, that's a screener for our high school students. So we've currently, and I shared this at the last meeting where we talked about this, we have program in place for our elementary and middle school with regard to SEL. But we don't have anything yet for high school district-wide, and so we asked for that, and we didn't put in enough money, I don't believe, for 1 year, and so we also would want to extend that for a couple more years, and our high school principals are discussing an SEL screener to use for our high school students. We also asked about Edmentum, our courseware, to replace Apex, and our high school principals and teachers chose Edmentum, not to be confused with the program that we did have for K through 8. It is the same company, but they have a high school product. We did not put quite enough money in our ESSER 2 proposal for this software. It was a little over $100,000, about $104,000 for 1 year, so we want to extend that contract beyond the 1 year. Social Studies Weekly, that's the weekly reader contract, and TeachTown was the special programs curriculum. On the next slide, we also asked for classroom libraries. We'd like to ask for additional funds there. Then regarding the new activities, we did ask for science lab equipment before for middle school. This would be for high schools. There's a need for calculators. And also, all of the webinars we've watched, and our State Department in particular, wants us to remember the whole child. It's very important to us to make sure that there are opportunities for the arts, and those students did experience learning loss in the arts. So we're asking to be able to use some of these funds for fine arts supplies, and talk about why fine arts class. So evening school program, so this is something that was one of the ideas from the high school principals to give additional opportunities for students to earn those credits, and just an alternative for them. The daytime program might not work so well for some of our students, and so to have an opportunity for them to earn their high school credits, and that would cost about $1.4 million, excuse me. Summer and Saturday trainings, one of the things we realized recently with all the programs we put into place, having the opportunity to train our teachers. In the past, we've done Saturday trainings. Our summer trainings are well attended and well responded to, so we're asking to put funds there to continue to support teachers, not after the workday ends, but on Saturdays when it is optional for them, or on or during the summer. And we know that every teacher won't take advantage, but those teachers who would like to get trainings out of the way, we'd like to be able to offer those. And so we put in funds for 500 teachers per year times 3 years, and then also some costs of external trainers who would come in. So that would be for all of those programs we mentioned, and instructional best practices, math interventions that teachers can implement, our standards, and using assessment data. Then we had someone mentioned during a board meeting about our media centers, and I think you've received information about where our media centers stand with regard to their collections. So we're asking to put $1 million towards increasing those collections. Next, we'd like to offer a fine arts summer camp for 1 to 2 weeks during the summer. And of course, that would be contingent on our being able to find staff for 2 weeks, but at least a 1 week program. The State Department of Ed has allocated $20 million of their funding to the South Carolina Arts Commission to subgrant to districts and local organizations for the arts to have programs and hopefully partner with school districts for summer and during the school year, maybe arts in residence programs. So we want to make sure that we're partnering with those and applying for the subgrants that are available to have a robust summer program for our arts students. So this would be in addition to Gateway. This wouldn't be something that the students would necessarily have to apply for, like Gateway is an audition and portfolio-driven program for our gifted arts students. This would be for students who'd like to attend for fine arts for summer. One of the uses in learning loss mentioned the assessment. So we have to pay for a universal screener. It's one of those unfunded state mandates, so we'd like to use the funds, since we're allowed to pay for that contract for Fast Bridge, which is kindergarten through two. And then in our session with our principals, middle school principals in particular have asked repeatedly for instructional coaches in their buildings to help teachers with strategies. And right now we can't find the people to fill all of our classroom vacancies, right? So we want to maybe try another route, and that would be there are some large educational organizations that do offer coaching, where they will come into our buildings and for 12 sessions and work with principals and teachers to coach them and model best practices and give instructional feedback. So this is an option for us we'd like to pursue. So we wrote it in so that we could investigate it as a possibility for our middle schools. But again, this is something that, like the K-2 interventionist positions, our elementary principals have been asking for that for years. So this funding gave us the opportunity to finally pursue that. This has been something the middle school principals have been asking for years. So we'd like for that to be considered. Also, behavior support training. This specifically right now is for the SIL, Center for Innovative Learning, our alternative school program aides and teachers, as well as providing that for our teachers if they would like to take advantage of the opportunity, but making sure that they know how to deal with behaviors that they experience. SAT and ACT workshops, having a contracted person come in for our students, we've had this in the past and it's been very successful. ESOL curriculum and training, this has been a need. Our ESOL students is one of those populations who needs special support. So we need curriculum for them that's designed specifically for ESOL, and we'd like to pursue that. Parent trainings and support is mentioned as a need to make sure that they can help their children with homework, use technology, and so we want to make sure we have some workshops available for them. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Ms. Glover. I know there's a lot of questions, or excuse me, a lot of topics we've still got to get to, but since this is sort of the end of the learning loss, I have a couple of questions. I don't want to get to the very end and have to come all the way back, if that's okay. Under the new activities for the very first bullet, are all those points for high school specifically, or is that just the lab equipment?
The lab equipment and the calculators.
Okay, and then fine arts is across?
Yes, sir.
Across the board, okay. Other question on the behavior support, you mentioned SIL. Is any of that directed towards Excel?
It could be. So actually, that was where we got the idea from. BCBA training and Ms. Taylor at Excel has made sure that, you know, that's part of her program, making sure her staff get appropriate training for behavior. So this is really tied into that.
Sure.
So their staff may be involved if they haven't already been trained.
And then the last thing, this isn't really a question, for the evening school and then the parental training, I know this is early phase, but I wouldn't mind seeing what that is envisioned at some point down the road to look like.
Okay.
That's it. Thank you.
Yes.
Ms. Club, I got a couple of just quick answers, if you don't mind. And I don't want to, like Mr. Crane says, I don't want to get too far ahead. Tell me what FNP kits are back on administrative feedback.
Fountas and Pinnell is our, it's where the teacher sits by a student and reads with the student, or the student reads to the teacher so the teacher can see how the student's progressing.
And what we're talking about where it says spending proposal, I don't, this may not have been worked out totally yet. And it says 500 teachers. What teachers will be trained? All of them? I mean, we got more than what these numbers support.
Yes, sir. So when we have done optional trainings on Saturdays and during the summer, so right now some of the programs that we purchased before with ESSER II, we're offering trainings all summer long, so teachers can come in and do that and not have to worry about when they get back to school getting that training, because many teachers plan over the summer and you'd like to get that out of the way. So we know that we won't have every teacher take advantage of that, so that's we estimated 500.
Okay. So what we're talking about, this is going to be a voluntary type training?
Yes, sir.
A mandatory training?
Yes, sir.
Finally, if you bear with me, I'm just trying to clear some things up in my head so I can keep the scope going. What is universal screener contracts?
So part of, and forgive me for not knowing the act, it's referred to as the dyslexia law. It's part of that law that says all K and 1 students, and 2 if they show some kind of reading difficulty, are screened at beginning of the year and midpoint of the year and the end of the year. And so FastBridge is the assessment that a teacher team chose. And so that would be to pay for that screener. Because the state doesn't fund it, but they tell, this is one of those things they tell us we have to do.
Okay, and just one screener and they'll be covering the county. Early childhood?
The teacher does the screener. So one of the trainings might be on, the trainings we talked about might be administering the FastBridge screener. or how to interpret the fast bridge trainer.
It's really a test, right?
It's a test, yes, sir.
Evaluation.
An assessment.
Just, I'm trying to think of all the needs we got, one teacher, or $76,000, I just wonder if that's enough, that's why I was asking now.
So the 76 is payment for the contract for the actual test.
Okay, see, that clears that, thank you.
You're welcome.
Good job.
Ms. Glover told me that she preferred all of the questions, so this. So, learning loss was our first item, and again, it's a minimum of 20%, but based on our estimates, there was a need to increase that above that 20%. Next item on the list is technology funding. So, between ESSER I, the coronavirus relief funds that I mentioned, and even some in ESSER II, we purchased approximately 15,000 devices at this point. Already had some like new devices that are working in combination with these 15,000 that we purchased over the last year or so. As we get towards the end of ESSER III, we're at the end of we're at that replacement cycle. And ESSER III gives us an opportunity to avoid hitting the general fund, to avoid hitting 8% funds or some other funds or funds in combination to pay for those replacements. So we're asking that funds be set aside for technology funding. This includes peripherals and charging stations and cords, things of a little bit lesser value, but largely those laptops. I think we heard the stat that we currently have about 22,000 laptops devices right now. So that's what we would be looking at replacing as ESSER III nears its end. But again, that third bullet here, ESSER III providing us the opportunity to avoid hitting the general fund and 8% money or other funding sources can't be understated. Thinking ahead, and it's not on this slide, we're probably looking at in the late 2020s, in mid-2030s, another replacement cycle. Not too early now to start thinking about how we may get to that point and what other sources may be there. So that's something that we'll continue to keep an eye on. We have several quick hitter items here. We had the 6 ed tech positions that were approved in ESSER II. That's in addition to the 6 ed tech positions that were approved over the last year or so funded out of the general fund. We're asking to continue those in 22-23, 23-24. The same for the curriculum technology specialist position. The board approved the purchase of an employee assistance program. That was one of the ESSER II revisions that we brought forth in May for consideration, continuing it for 2 years beyond the current. And all of these items that you see as continuations, including the early reading interventionists, early interventionists that were listed up under learning loss, all of those are items that as we near the end of ESSER III, we would be evaluating. Are these things that we need to build into the general fund or build into other funding sources? Do we wish to continue beyond the exhaustion of these federal dollars here, and how could we do that? Item 6, again, a continuation. This is a revision that the board approved at its most recent meeting for 2 preventative maintenance mechanics. ESSER III would give us 2
sanitizer. And this next item, dual modality.
Yeah, yes, sir.
So where do, you're gonna tell us how much and where do we think we're gonna ask teachers to teach in person and virtually at the same time?
So you're asking.
So the dual modality means that's money so that teachers can be in the classroom and basically with a camera or something at the very same time teach students at home.
It,
so I'm just curious, is that just a reserve in case we have to, or do we already know that we're gonna have to do that?
Well, so a couple of things. We anticipate having to do that. There's that example I gave at the leadership summit, and I don't know if it's entirely accurate, but I think it probably provides a good example. Let's say that we have an ROTC instructor or something that's very specialized, and the large majority of those students are face-to-face, but there are one or two AI students. It's not going to make a whole lot of sense to hire a new instructor for a small number. So yes, those we would have to compensate because they have dual modes. But we've also had the question recently, and just got some clarification yesterday or today, and we are still getting some additional info, but what happens when we have a classroom full of face-to-face students and some students go on quarantine? And they join the class through Teams. They're a normal face-to-face. They're not AI, so this teacher is dealing with those students in class, face-to-face, but you also have some on the computer. We would have to compensate those, too. Now, legislation passed this year to say that if a teacher is participating in dual modality, we have to compensate them. There isn't a dollar amount, there are no guidelines there, and that's something that we would work to develop. Again, we are still getting some additional clarification on the situation where what happens if students are quarantined. And, right. And I don't think that was the original intent. I think the original intent was, if this teacher that's teaching 100 students face-to-face, and you also need them to teach 10 students virtually. This is a number I could see that budget estimate increasing some on that too over time. Just, it's a difficult number to gauge.
Mm-hmm. But that's there for essentially for a supplement. That's not the technical term for it, but it's like a supplement.
It is on top of their normal pay, yes, sir. And it's, again, it's required by legislation.
Yeah, and the example you brought up, which was not the original intent, about, because we all saw it this past year, I saw it with one of my two kids, is, you know, what do you do with children that are on quarantine? That's a much better way is a much better way of handling it. If they're actually not sick, is there some idea that we would be ready to do that school year after this one, I'm curious, because you kind of opened the door on that one.
We would be prepared to do it now.
Okay.
I mean, if we were using the Teams program, the teacher could set up a Teams room, and while teaching the regular face-to-face class, students at home could tune in and do it that way. Interaction would be difficult, but the students would still be able to be part of the class from home. Not as good, probably, as, you know, a moving camera that can follow the teacher, but the student would be able to see, and as long as the teacher was in the proximity of the camera, would be able to see the teacher.
Could we not just put one camera at the end of the room and capture the whole classroom?
Are you running the camera for the students?
So this, whenever we established this original estimate, it was prior to getting some clarification on some other things we may have to consider in those cases of quarantine. So again, this may be an estimate that if it's not up in the original plan, we may find that there's a need at some point during the future in this fluid plan to update that.
Several of us on the board have mentioned that we would like to see some kind of satellite classes to be able to offer some of the more advanced classes to some of the outlying schools that maybe doesn't have the population. Is there an opportunity with this to include some of that, or would that not go along with the ESSER funds? And that may be something you may have to get back.
That's probably something we might want to get back with you on, Mr. Smith.
That is something that several of us are interested in seeing.
Yeah, I really think we have to be, it's time to be creative with this. I mean, there's got to be a better way of dealing with kids on quarantine or kids who are at home sick or whatever than just giving them some prepared computer thing to look at. We've got to have an interactive way of trying to keep these kids as part of the class. And I got to believe there's a way to do that. And we can start by getting a legal review of a camera in the classroom thing. And even if we have to have parental sign-off on it, after explaining why we want the camera in the classroom. That kind of thing. I mean, all I'm trying to say is I think it's not going to go away for the next 3.5 years because I'm going to be here yelling about it 3.5 more years. So, I really want to point that out. I'm done. Thank you.
We will continue to gather additional info. We anticipate some additional guidance from the State Department on this as well. The item number 10, indirect costs, we're able to charge ESSER 3 for a portion of costs that aren't directly, maybe don't relate as directly to ESSER 3, but come into play here. Common purpose, behind the scenes things, we're incurring costs for payroll, for our procurement department, for personnel, etc., and we're able to reimburse the general fund for part of those costs. And this was the low percentage on the indirect costs. That's a percentage that the State Department updates every year based on a formula and a variety of factors. So we included that in these funds. Now the last item on this list, and we mentioned among those new items, the new of the 15 is construction of a new Wagner Sally High School. Just some of the highlights, and I think a lot of the folks here are aware of this, but the original structure was built in 1939. We have an old HVAC system. There's no air in the hallways. You have limited electrical outlets, roof leaks, and despite the roof being repaired 10 years ago, we have a lot of issues with it simply due to the age of the building. We heard that the basement below the auditorium floods and there's sitting mortar in there. You have wooden lockers that are porous. They're not easy to clean, unlike some of the metal lockers in schools. There's poor ventilation, mold issues, moisture issues.
the, so I think this is a very key point here. Not only the desire to construct new, but as we go to the State Department, as we ask them to consider this as part of our plan, if that's something that the board ultimately approves as part of this proposal, we would have to show that it's more cost effective to build new than to renovate a building and add those improvements. Now we think that the items listed here and just what it would take to bring this building up to the appropriate level would cost more than building new, but that's something I think that the State Department's going to be looking for out of us. The other thing to keep in mind is that right now Wagner Sally isn't on the 8% plan until the 24-25 school year, so on the 5-year facilities plan. Right now the plan would be for the 8% funds to work either solely on its own over multiple years, or if phase two of the penny sales tax passed in November 24 to work in combination with 8%. So if we were able to utilize ESSER 3 funds, we could avoid that need in 24-25 or some of that, or we get a jump start on it and really address the core facility. But right now we're looking at 3 to 4 years out for doing anything at Wagner Sally in all likelihood without the use of these ESSER 3 funds. Yes.
What exactly are we proposing to do with this 25882? Is that we're just going to put it aside until 24-25, or are we going to start building sooner, or what's the plan?
Well, okay. Our deadline is September 30 of 2024 for these funds to be spent. If we don't receive those funds, so beginning the planning process, and Dr. Murphy or Mr. Lawrence may want to chime in, but beginning that planning process and getting moving on that original core facility and taking advantage of these funds, just knowing how long the approval process is going to take, knowing that at the state level, because of ESSER 2 and because of ESSER 3, they have a lot more plans, I suspect, than they're accustomed to approve. So jumping on that as soon as possible, I think, would be the plan.
Yes, sir, that is correct. As soon as we got state approval on the ESSER 3 plan, we would hit the ground running to build. Yes, sir.
So talking about building versus renovation, I don't think it's going to be difficult to show that. I mean, there's a reason we haven't done things out there, because it's just cost prohibitive, but I know y'all will be prepared to show that. Do we feel like this falls within the 15 allowable uses? I mean, I know there's a little bit of wiggle room there. To put item 11, Wagner Sally?
We do. Again, the HVAC, you could tie it into technology, which is big here. The
sure.
Air filtration in items, I think it would hit multiple items here. And I do feel I'm not the facilities guy out the group, obviously, but I do recall, and it was a little bit different situation, but we talked about years ago LaBelle McCampbell. Do you gut it and redo it on site, or do you build new on this new piece of property? And what we found was that there was approximately $1 million difference between gutting that original facility versus building brand new off-site, and in the meanwhile, what do you do with the students too? So I think about that situation as I think about this, but I believe that we can relate it with the issues that we've identified, some others that likely haven't been included, just so we have a brief summary of this. I think we can make our case to the State Department.
Yeah, that was the case with Aiken Elementary, Lawrence Street Elementary, go,
sure,
you know, been torn down. You have to break, if you spend a certain percentage, a certain amount of money, you have to.
Well, I'm in favor of knocking it down, not.
Yeah. I mean, you have to break a whole school.
That's great. I mean, I've been to now two in-depth tours of the campus, and it, I mean, I've seen the pump in the basement through the water floods it. The only thing I would request is if this gets authorized by the state, obviously that's a, you know, don't put the cart before the horse. I would love to see the auditorium retained somehow. As far as structurally, I mean, that's outside of the purview of this, but I'll just toss it out here. That's a beautiful facility. We spent a lot of money on it.
It seems to me like we ought to be able to save some of that.
Yeah, I think, because it's not really a problem here other than the basement, maybe we could.
Yeah, look at building a new school on the same site, retaining a few of those buildings.
We'll let architects figure that one out, but I'll just toss it out there.
And this pot of money, it wouldn't be sufficient enough to rebuild new totally, so it may be something working in combination with some other funds as well.
Yeah, I just want to go back a little bit on a couple of things.
Yes, sir.
And this might be for Dr. Murphy. Seeing the technology purchases, I want to make sure the last few laptops that we bought with previous funds, are they all implemented? Or do we, you know, how much more do we have to deliver to classrooms, and when do we think we'll be done?
Well, good evening. That's a little bit harder question to answer because of this current supply chain. So we get them in batches. We just received a batch of about 3,000 laptops. We currently have enough to give, we're at 1-to-1 right now. We're still waiting on the K2, I think the last batch of the K2 computers are coming in now.
The next thing was, I don't think, if we thought it was a good idea at some point, can we pay for the COVID type leave that we were paying for this past school year in these funds?
That would fall under this, okay. Yes, sir.
And currently we're not planning on having any type of extra COVID leave this year, or we are?
We don't have a recommendation on that at this point, no, sir.
And that, outside of the original funds included in ESSER II to cover us through June 30, we hadn't planned or recommended any additional.
Okay. Indeed. All right. So we're, and just to make sure I understand, then, if a teacher or a member of staff is asked to quarantine because of a close contact at school, how are we handling that this school year?
That would be very similar to what we've done in the previous year. If they were considered to be, what's the term?
Critical
infrastructure. Then they would be able to continue to teach, maintaining the 6 feet of distance at least, and some other strategies. There may be some situations where the teacher wouldn't be able to be in the school, but I think we would look at, I think the word creative was used earlier. We would try to find some creative ways for that person to continue to teach. You could work what we mentioned about quarantine students in reverse, you know, for less than $100 a day, we've got a sub in the classroom to manage the class, with the teacher actually teaching remotely. So I think there are ways that we can do that and ensure that instruction continues, even though, of course not, it wouldn't work if the teacher was sick, but if the teacher is healthy and quarantined, we would be able to work it that way.
Okay, thank you. I just got two more things to Dr. Brownlee. The first one, I just want to thank everybody, the team that put together the proposal, I appreciate it. And, you know, if the state approves it, I'm sure the 300-plus students at Wagner-Sally can enjoy a real improvement to their environment once that's done. And it was nice to see that we were able to address some learning loss through some additions to our libraries. I'm assuming, the last question I had is, so based on what I saw, I'm assuming that we got very little or no feedback on the survey about year-round school calendar.
I think it was one.
Okay.
I didn't realize we had one. I think you and I talked earlier.
Yeah.
But yeah, there was one response.
So this, I don't have any other questions, but my statement on this is, so when I see that, so we have learning loss, there's gaps we need to address. We're planning on continuing to have summer schools like we had this year, at least for a couple more years. You know, we'll see how effective that is with post-testing. Just anecdotally, I'm just concerned about student and teacher burnout. And if you don't go to a year-round calendar without support from the community. I guess that's, if anybody's particularly watching, I would say, speak up. You know, we may explore this issue this coming school year for the future. I think it's not easy, but what I'm saying is it's probably a less expensive way to prevent learning loss with breaks so that you don't burn out. And there's a lot of other side benefits to it. So I encourage you, if anybody's watching, contact you. If you're interested in that kind of thing, speak up so that people know you're there. Thank you.
Are you talking about spread to 185 days over the entire year or additional days in the calendar job that year round?
What I'm saying is to have a modified year round calendar so that you don't have a big summer break. That is.
With the 185 days?
Yep. I still think you experience less learning loss that way.
If I might add something, and Mr. Lawrence might chime in too, or tell me to exhibit. One thing that we may be looking at doing too is a survey at the conclusion of summer to get parent input and teacher input to really gauge how well things went, how beneficial it was, and maybe what some of those issues are.
We also had the opportunity to look, I think three or four school districts began using a year-round calendar this year and actually started yesterday. So we'll be watching those closely, see how well they did.
Mr. Chairman, maybe I should have piled on Ms. Glover, back during the learning loss section. But the first bullet point under new ESSER, or new activities in ESSER 3, seems to me that first bullet point, just a comment for consideration, it could be understated, I think. I believe that some of these things like lab equipment and other activities are probably hard for schools to budget for and get under normal, you know, budget scenarios. So I think we've got an opportunity to really address some of the places where we may have been deficient in the past. And so it seems to me maybe that could be understated. But also, I recall during our last budget session, there was a presentation made to the board that was an ask for a number of items to be addressed. But one of those, again, I think is an opportunity here, and that's the band equipment upgrade. I don't recall the number that was put forth. I'm just bringing it up that maybe we can go back and look at that and see if we can address that under these guidelines to address that ask and that need that apparently has been brought to us. If we could look at that, I'd appreciate it.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
I
If I could add one thing there as a reminder too, we, in addition to this, which would supplement what we have in the general fund, we do have recurring fine arts supplies budgets that are allocated to every single school at every level. It's a higher amount, I think it's $165,000-ish at the high school level allocated based on enrollment for the school, and then we have middle and elementary amounts as well, so.
Some of that money could be used for musical instruments also.
It could, in addition to some of these fine art supplies as well, supplement.
But one thing, I don't know if that's the best way to spend the money or not, but one thing to think about, we knew going into what we approved for this summer school programs that we more than likely were not going to spend what we allocated, right? Probably have not.
That's correct, and that speaks back to the fluidity of the plan,
right,
and the state requiring us to spend chronologically. So as we see that, you know, we didn't spend as much here, we spent more here, I would anticipate us coming back with some more amendments.
Yes. So I imagine, my point being to your question, Mr. Silas, I think there's some money that I think is going to come back to us that we're going to have, with recommendations from the district, that we're going to have to think about how we're going to spend it the second time. Because summer school is never full, right? You plan to invite a lot and half of them choose to attend.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Just back to the Wagner Sally. Do we have a tentative plan B for the $25 million in ESSER funds if that is a no-go?
I think probably on Wagner Sally, again, this is my thought, and I'm not really answering your question what plan B is. I think we're probably caught in a situation here where we could show that it qualifies, but showing that it qualifies for new construction versus additions and renovations may be the bigger issue. Again, that's something, submitting this plan August 24th doesn't guarantee that every component in here is going to be approved. So I think we would have the opportunity to revisit if there were components that the state didn't approve, and we can see how best to address some of these other issues or add to it.
And we are confident, based on conversations that we've had, that this project would meet the requirements of ESSER 3. It's just a matter, like Mr. Traxler mentioned, of would they approve a renovation or would they approve a new build? But that would come with negotiations once it's approved.
We need to adopt this plan.
Yes, sir. We need to adopt it as a draft.
And
so what that really means then is we need a motion to adopt this plan and a second and a vote. Anybody like to make
it? I'll make a motion that we adopt the plan, the draft plan, as it being presented by the administration.
I'm going to go ahead and take the vote. We'll get Mr. Silas chime in.
I'll second.
A motion is second to adopt a plan presented by the administration. Any further discussion? All in favor, please raise your hand. That's everyone, and we'll get Mr. Silas' vote when he gets back. The second item on the agenda is textbook adoption for 21-22. So, did you need to say anything? We've all got the list.
We're here to answer questions, if you have any.
Anybody have a question? Is there a motion to, Mr. Green makes the motion, is there a second? Oh, do you want to
I have a question.
Okay, go ahead.
No, but I'll make the motion after that.
All right.
Well, not really a question, but I did come up and look through all the books, and it was impressive. It was an impressive stack of stuff, and then, you know, had the ones that had the pink sticky note saying these are appreciate the opportunity to come up and take a look at them. I know there's a lot behind the scenes. Normally, this is a little earlier in the year, right? This is kind of from the state delaying on some of that. Okay.
Yes.
I was asked about that. I thought that was the case. I will make a motion that we go ahead and adopt these textbooks that have been presented to us.
Second.
Second, but I know, Dr. Hanks. Any further discussion? All in favor, please raise your hand. Just for the record, Mr. Silas indicated that he would vote in favor of the recommendation to adopt the ESSER plan, correct?
That's correct, yes.
So that was unanimous vote, 6-0. Third item is personnel appointments. We've all been supplied with a list of individuals who have been recommended for employment by the administration. That's great.
Mr. Chair, I have a motion to amend the list in one manner. The pages are not numbered, but if you go to the second to last page, the second position from the top is a position at Silver Bluff. I've had quite a number of folks reach out with some questions. That decision was made about a week and a half ago. I would like to move that position be removed for consideration until the Silver Bluff administration can meet with the area council folks that are interested, just to have more of a conversation about it, about that particular position. It's an athletic position. That season's not until the spring, so it shouldn't put a delay out if we wait a week or so on that. And I did ask Mr. Lawrence about that. He didn't see any issues there. But I want to make that motion that we amend the list and essentially remove that name from consideration until after the Silver Bluff administration can meet with their area council about it.
So we got a motion. Is there a second?
That's second. Okay. Yes, I do. A second.
Okay. Any further discussion? All in favor, please raise your hand. Opposed? All right. That's 5-1.
Thank you.
Third, what we did there is we voted to remove that position from the list. Now we have to vote on the list. Is there a motion to approve the list as amended?
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Smith. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Second by Mr. Crane. Any further discussion? All in favor, please raise your hand. That's everybody. All right. The next item is a back to school safety plan revision. Mr. Lawrence?
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. You got the plan that was approved in May, and as Mr. Traxler mentioned, that's part of the American Recovery Act. Thank you. Since that approval, the State Department of Education has relaxed its requirements on masks on school buses. And so what this does is puts our plan in line with the State Department. We already had masks as parental choice and voluntary for adults in the schools. This just extends that same policy to school buses.
That's the only modification?
That's the only modification we're recommending at this time.
Any questions?
So I don't have a question about the new content or the actual revision. One of the things that's not addressed in here is about, unless I missed it, was visitors in school. I can't do it's not a searchable PDF, so I can't search for it. When I went through it, I don't remember seeing it. And if I'm wrong, just tell me I'm wrong. But what I want to make sure of is I've read some of these plans from other districts, and some of them are extremely high level and short. Do we have this last school year, we had a back to school safely community manual, had a lot of detail in it. That was for last school year. That wasn't for this school year.
Right.
Do we have clear direction for the schools on how we're handling everything, or at least what's a school decision and what's not, and how we're doing things? Visitors in the school is one of those things on the list, right? I think you'd have a policy around. I just want to make sure, you know, we're 2 weeks out or so, you know, have, is there clear direction to the schools?
Yes, sir. We had a conversation with principals and other school administrators today and went through some of those details that, that aren't in that plan. And we'll certainly have that ready for the public very soon. When it comes to visitors, we are following the same policy that we followed last year, especially with the rising trend in our community, with, well, the whole state, but particularly in our community. We don't feel this is a good time to relax those requirements on additional people in schools.
Follow up to that. I've already seen a lot of elementary parents wonder if they're going to walk their child to school on day one. That means no.
Yes, sir, that's correct.
They will not be able to do that. Thank you, sir.
When we adopt this plan, does that mean that we are still doing the 25%? Well, not the 25%, the percentages that we use to signal quarantine or closure, or going back to the hybrid model, all that kind of stuff, or is all that dead in the water?
No, yes, sir. I believe my interpretation is that the authority that the board gave me back in February is still in force. So we will be going back to school on August 16th. In our traditional model with all students in school every day. But if conditions warranted, and I don't have those in front of me right now, but if we reach those thresholds that we talked about then I would have to make a decision on whether to become more restrictive at that particular school.
Another question. If a child 12 or older is inoculated, do they have quarantine?
I'm gonna ask Ms. Hart to address that, because I've heard a couple of different suggestions on that. But
so if an individual is considered a close contact to a positive case and they have been fully vaccinated for at least 2 weeks, and provided they're not symptomatic, then they would not have to quarantine. So if someone were symptomatic and had been vaccinated, they would have to quarantine. Or if someone had just received their second dose 2 days ago, it would not have been long enough and they would have to quarantine.
I have one thing, back to Mr. Nussel's point on visitors. Is that outside the scope of this, or should it be included? Or are we, how are we communicating that as part of us? School safety plan?
Well, we're looking at updating the plan that's already in place on the website to be in line with this back to the in-person instruction plan. That plan was template based, so we basically answered the questions as they presented the questions to us, and our protocols and our recommendations to schools are more detailed than that. So, and the visitor piece is included in that.
Okay, I suppose as long as it's clearly communicated, then that's the point.
I got to speak, if I may, speak up on this. I got a problem with telling parents at this point they can't bring their children into school, especially their early grades. And that's one that parents look forward to, and unless something comes up between now and school start, I don't see any reason to restrict them. Am I missing something, or is there something I don't know?
Well, sir, our logic is, you know, as of right now, COVID numbers in Aiken County are at the same level that they were back in November and are continuing to rise just about every day. And so based on that, we feel like we need to have the same level of restrictions that we had back in November.
But the policy you're proposing for the opening of school this year was what you did last year, right? parents able to bring their kids to school?
No, sir. No, sir.
That's you.
No, sir.
So this is not a new?
No, sir. With the exception of masks, we're recommending pretty much the same mitigation measures that we had last year.
Thanks. This may be another thing that I missed in what we've got here, but I didn't see any mention of the use of plexiglass dividers in general. Are we using plexiglass dividers in our classrooms on every desk?
We have them available, and we're certainly asking that they be used in small group situations, like a teacher with a kidney table and instructing students in a small group. The plexiglass dividers that we were able to purchase are very difficult to use with fidelity. And if they're not being used with fidelity, then they're creating a problem for instruction. Students aren't able to see the board or the smart board. Teachers aren't able to interact with the teacher. They become a hazard for moving, which of course in this situation we don't move a lot anyway, but we just think that they create more of a problem when they're used universally in the classroom than not. However, they are available and in every school, enough for all of the student desks. So if we determine that we need to enforce that, we will. And certainly if a teacher or a principal wants that to be the case in that school or classroom, that's going to be available to them.
We need to vote to modify this. We do need to vote to modify the safety plan. Is there a motion? The modification was to eliminate mask wearing on school buses.
So I would move to accept the recommendation.
Yes.
And the revisions of the plan.
Right. Second. Anyone?
Second.
Second by Mr. Gray. Any further discussion? All in favor, please raise your hand. Opposed? All right, that brings us through. First of all, the next item on the agenda was instructional policy review. When I put that on the agenda, I was anticipating us being through at a much earlier hour than we are now. So, and I was going to restrict it to 30 minutes. And Ms. Lowe was going to walk us through some policy. Now we have it's 7:30. And we got an item for executive session that may take a little while. So I'm going to suggest that we defer the continuation of reviewing the instructional policies to a later date. So I don't know if anybody has a problem with that. Now would be time to speak up.
Point of order. Do we need to modify?
Probably need it? To table it would be the easiest way. Somebody can make a motion to table it.
A motion that we table it.
Postpone session for later.
Okay. All in favor of table it. Somebody second. Did you second it, Mr. Clark?
Oh, well, sure.
Okay, good. All in favor, please raise your hand. Thank you. We will need an executive session this evening to go into additional executive session for the purpose of considering the following matters as appropriate discussion of property matter. So if there's any action to be taken after discussion in executive session, we will do so in open session following. But when we reconvene in here following the executive session. Let's adjourn to executive session.
I move to adjourn to executive session.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, please raise your hand. Let's meet in the Kennett room at about 10 minutes. executive session, we engaged in a discussion about property matter, and there's no action to be, that's required at this time. So I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
Moved by Mr. Salas, seconded by Mr. Smith, all in favor, please raise your hand. That's it. Thank you very much.
My thoughts. Don't forget your phone, Brian.
Oh, thank you. That's why my keys are back there.